Hi everyone, in this video we're going to be talking about avoiding creative blocks and how to stay inspired. Now of course there's no all-encompassing solution that will work for every type of personality, but I do have a few ideas I'd like to share, and then you can see if any of them could apply to you. Now before we get into it, I just want to share that Southern Shotty, one of the other hosts of the Blenderness podcast, is releasing a course on the MoGraph Mentor website about creating stylized characters in Blender. It's aimed towards intermediate and advanced users who want to learn how to model and rig characters in Blender with an emphasis on stylized artwork. It launches on the 25th of this month and there's a pre-sale happening until the release, so now is the best time to sign up. I'm sure that a lot of you are already familiar with Southern Shotty. He consistently has a high production value with his channel and always finds good ways to explain complex subjects. If you're interested in signing up for it, then by using my affiliate link in the description, then you will also be massively helping to support this channel. Alright, so let's get into the subject of the video. Creative blocks are something that everyone in creative or creative technical fields will bump into throughout their lives. I consider myself lucky that creative blocks are not something that I frequently struggle with. However, more often than not, I find myself struggling with an issue on the other end of the spectrum, which is having too many things I want to make, and not enough time or lack of cohesion between the projects to bring many of them to a functional or finished state. This is partly the reason why so much of the content on this channel is kind of all over the place rather than focus into a specific subject. The question of how to avoid creative blocks is something that I briefly answered back in the 20,000 subscriber Q&A video. The key points I provided in my original response were the following. Constantly surround yourself with sources of inspiration that resonate with you, learn how to sustain the excitement of having new ideas, and avoid performing actions that will cause frustration. Taking a look at these in more detail, find things that can provide you with emotional stimulation. This can often be difficult for people who don't know exactly what that is. Quite often, it's a matter of finding consumable entertainment that aligns with your ideals or contains types of meanings, sounds, visuals, or so on that you naturally gravitate to. If you don't know what kind of content gives you the most satisfaction, then the best way to discover this is through experimentation. It's no secret I love science fiction type content. In regards to visuals, the color range between cyan and purple tends to give me the most emotional feedback, so I employ this in my work to make me happier when creating things. When working on projects and coming up with ideas, I listen to music that employs a lot of synthesizers, often ranging between ambient soundscapes and more intense synth pop genres. I've often found that synthetic tracks with seemingly random beats and melodies that ebb and flow in and out of focus somehow help me maintain concentration, and consequently make me more productive. Music with lyrics makes me feel more hyped, but also more likely to click away and start browsing random websites on autopilot. My behavioral reactions to different types of content is not something that I've researched. These are just personal quirks that I've discovered through experimentation, so I'd encourage others to do the same. Learn how to sustain the excitement of having new ideas. Turn this excitement into a slower burn. This will be a key factor in not letting the motivation run dry. It happens very often, primarily for newer learners, for the excitement of a cool new idea to become overwhelming. Without doing much research, they will jump straight into trying to bring the idea to life without the right amount of prerequisite skill or knowledge. A common result of this is they will bump into one issue after another and become so frustrated before succumbing to a negative mood, draining the motivation and consequently abandoning the idea, aka welcome to the world of indie game development. But how do you get around this? Well, that excitement of having a new idea is a powerful tool. And if you stop to break down the project into smaller modular parts, then you can focus more on planning and taking easier to manage steps. But yes, you will have to come to terms with a longer time investment. By taking smaller steps, it will take you a longer time to reach the final goal. But by tackling many smaller challenges, you will often find yourself going further and learning more in the long term, compared to if you had tried to take on the entire project at once and failed almost immediately. Frustration will occur when things don't turn out the way you expected. It's a natural part of the learning process, and your results and knowledge will get better over time, but it requires patience. When encountering frustration caused by a lack of knowledge, take it as an opportunity to learn something new. Research the issue, acquire new sources of knowledge related to the subject, and then focus on finding new ways to utilize these tools to solve the issue. As much as you may want to, you can't solve every issue with your own mind, but a path to success can often be found in the work shared by others. The internet is undoubtedly the best resource for information, especially for creative technical fields. And let's face it, 90% of all programming solutions can be found on Stack Overflow. Succeeding in overcoming issues by acquiring new information will likely present you with new possibilities that could ultimately change the direction of your entire project. With that in mind, be willing to adapt the direction of your ideas in response to the growth of your own knowledge. But how do these points relate to creative blocks and maintaining the feeling of being inspired? How creative an individual can be is restricted not only by the amount of knowledge they possess and stimulus they have experienced, but also by how easily the brain can create links between this information. I believe that the idea of creativity is inherently tied to the way that an individual onboards new information while learning, with important factors being emotional stimulation and the act of intentionally trying to visualize links between separate subjects. If someone attempts to combine new skills and fails to do so, then they will likely make the mistake of subconsciously remembering failure as the only possible outcome. Let's take the example of learning a programming language. Memorizing the syntax and understanding all of the features in isolation is good, but completely useless without being tied to functionality in any way. If you don't apply that information practically, then you won't know how to make anything when it comes to putting that knowledge to the test. For example, I hardly know anything about the core theory behind the Python language, and yet I frequently use it to build tools for Blender. It's actually become one of the key sources of income for my work. But alas, I don't know many of the correct terms specific to the language. That's because instead of learning the language as an isolated subject, what I actually do is learn how to use it as a tool that extends my pre-existing knowledge. In doing so, I am continuously making links between the features of the language and Blender. While I'm learning the language, I'm also doing mental exercises to see how the same code would be written in another language, like C#. This way, I am making links with previous knowledge in a way that will make transitioning between the languages easier in the future. It also means that while learning a new skill, the experience with related skill sets is also being reinforced at the same time. As you experiment with new techniques, you teach yourself about potential, meaning all the possibilities of the things you can now make with the newly acquired knowledge. This means that by learning skills in a way that connects with previous knowledge, when you come back to make use of those skills, the ways in which they can be combined to create new ideas will be much more obvious and easier to work with than if those skills had been learned completely in isolation. Strictly speaking, you can increase your future creative potential by learning new skills in a way that interfaces with previous knowledge. What can we do to increase our creativity? With what we've just said in mind, it stands to reason that if we want to improve the way we visualize the potential ways to combine ideas in our minds and consequently help ourselves from falling into creative blocks, then there are a few things we need to achieve. To take the compartmentalized knowledge, concepts, and experiences of stimulation in our minds and find ways to increase their connectivity, this would involve relearning skills that you have already obtained, intentionally picking pre-existing skills and knowledge, and setting yourself the challenge of combining them into something new. The more similar these elements are, the easier it will be to do, because the gap to bridge them will require less effort to fill. And to obtain new skills and combine it with old knowledge rather than storing it as separate information. This means that by learning new skills, you should intentionally try to combine them with old experience to help form an obvious connection. The less relevant the skills are to each other, the more difficult this will be to achieve, but the more effective the results will be. To assist with the idea of increasing creativity through smarter learning, we need to talk about the power of the sense of discovery. The way in which we encounter new information is an important factor in whether or not we will retain that information in long-term memory. What's more than this is that if the information is acquired while we are emotionally stimulated and motivated about our work, then it will be easier to excite our minds into generating new ideas. This is why finding ways to stay emotionally engaged while learning is a key point to success in staying inspired. But that's of course easier said than done. How would you go about staying emotionally stimulated while learning? Consider the opposite of being frustrated while learning is to surprise yourself by achieving things that exceed your expectations. In my opinion, a key to staying excited while learning is to learn from material where the process will lead you to results where you are constantly surprised by what you have achieved. Unfortunately, finding content that fits your specific level of expectation is a challenge, since it's entirely subjective to your personality. The importance of excitement in learning is one of the main reasons why I try to provide so many free resources with the educational content on this channel. For a member of the audience, recreating the content in the videos is frustrating and there's so much room for things to go wrong. Playing with the tools and demos that already look good and can be modified in any way creates a more enjoyable and hopefully memorable experience. Brent Patterson makes a key point about curiosity and discovery in relation to teaching Blender in his Don't Go Pro talk at the Blender conference in 2018. They state, "I learned quite early on that if you couple emotion and emotional experience with learning, then they don't have to study. The learning happens automatically. You couple an emotional experience with learning by creating situations where the students are going to make discoveries." They also share a quote by Sir Ken Robinson that says, "Divergent thinking is the essential capacity for creativity." I think this is where the solution lies for avoiding creative blocks and staying inspired. The solution is not a one-shot action or state of mind, but rather a shift in mental lifestyle in regards to how we input, store, and feel about the knowledge we obtain. Making personal discoveries in the process of obtaining new knowledge and skills is one way to increase the emotional stimulation of the learning experience. All of this discussion about the methodology of learning is good, but what about immediate action? We all know that people want fast and easy solutions to complex issues. If you've just spent the last few hours really struggling with creative blocks, and you're feeling really burnt out and not interested in dealing with conceptual ideas about mentality, then I would suggest taking small actions to remove yourself from your usual environment. Go for a walk, meditate, listen to a type of music that you usually wouldn't. Try to shift yourself into a state of mind that you usually wouldn't explore. Being able to adjust your mental state with the use of new stimulus is a beneficial skill for effective creativity and avoiding some of the negative aspects of mental health that come from self-imposed pressure, often stemming from insecurities to perform and meet our own expectations, especially when comparing ourselves to other people. All in all, I hope this exploration of ideas helps you in some way. Again, this is just my personal take on the subject, and I'm sure that there are those of you that will have your own opinions on each of these points. Feel free to comment below to carry on the discussion. Before we close this up, I want to talk about the sponsor for this week's video. Yep, that's right, we actually have a sponsor this time. You might find this strange, considering I've said in the past that sponsorships have no place on this channel. But the reason I'm making an exception today is because the sponsor for this video is Sketchfab. Sketchfab is not just some random company trying to get their grubby hands on the Blender community. No, they've actually been closely intertwined with the Blender community for years. In fact, you might not be aware, but the same guy who manages the popular Blender Artists and Blender Nation websites is also the head of community at Sketchfab. Now, for those of you that don't know, Sketchfab provides a 3D viewing tool which lets you share your work with other people online. On their site, you can browse other people's work and even take your own scenes and embed them into your own sites with a wide range of options. It's useful for individual portfolios and even enterprise businesses that want to provide their customers with high-quality interactive visualizations. A lot of you will already be familiar with the viewer service that Sketchfab provides, but one thing you might not know is that they now have a proper marketplace where you can buy and sell 3D models. And of course, you can preview the content available using their viewing tool, which also provides a comprehensive model inspector, so you can see exactly what you're buying. No need to worry about surprise geometry. And honestly, sometimes I find myself coming to the site just to admire the artwork, because the quality level from some of the sellers is insane. So I highly recommend checking out the website, I'll definitely be using it in the future, and if you're interested in selling some of your own content on the site, then you can also consider applying to become a seller. Alright, that's where we're going to end the video, hopefully you found it useful. If you have any stories about your own struggles with creative blocks or have any ideas to keep other people inspired, then feel free to share them in the comments. Don't forget to follow me on social media for updates, and consider joining our Discord server to take part in discussions and challenges, share your work, and get sneak previews of upcoming projects. So thanks for watching, have a great day, and I'll see you next time.